Who wants to do heat transfer modeling? With butterfly CFD, we're not just able to look at air movement and airflow and airspeed. We can also look at the temperature distribution together with the airflow in an indoor environment, for example. Taking into account the indoor temperature and the temperature of the source, which is either an open window where the source is the outdoor temperature, or it's an air conditioning unit. In order to speed up the process, we will reuse the previous video, which is called Airflow, a first script butterfly CFD tutorial. I will put the link into the show note. If you haven't seen any CFD video, any of my CFD videos, I would encourage you to look at this entire playlist and go through and check, first of all, the installation and how to just run butterfly together with your Rhino installation. All right, you hopefully remember this previous script. We just keep it as it is. I will not change anything because it's just about explaining the method. Very quickly, we had some initial geometry, which is the box with cut it out windows, and we had a source source where the wind came in a certain speed. And the boundaries, we had to specify what kind of boundary condition that is. The box is a wall boundary. Then we had an indoor inlet boundary with a certain vector. I just have a vector here, like a line is a vector, where the length defines the speed. It's not visible here because I turn it off. Can make it visible so you can see actually this here. That's the wind speed. We will just keep that as it is. And they all had a name. They need to have a name in Butterfly CFD, otherwise you're gonna run into issues. Don't worry about too much about these things. This is just to make it more readable and visible, so we can see the boundary of the box and also the windows and the inflow and outflows. We also defined an outflow, which are these three windows here. So I just combined three surfaces. You have a cutout, but then you need still have a surface which defines the area of the outflow. And as you can see here, you can specify temperatures, and we haven't defined temperatures before because we also only looked into the velocity of the air and its movement. And we just keep all these things here and we just modify the script so we can also measure the temperature. For that, we need a different recipe. There's this recipe here, the heat transfer, butterfly heat transfer recipe. That's what we need. And we just delete this one. Now my solution is gone. A solution is not gone, but the calculation data. We can use this and just place it in here. Interestingly, it actually measures both. You can both measure the air movement and the temperature with this. What else do we need? We need here, we look at all the values, the vectors. We looked at how can we visualize the vector. So we have these arrows for the wind. Instead of like using the mesh for the air movement, I want to use it for the temperature. For that, we need a different field, because at the moment we're only checking the velocity, which is this field U. You know, we specified U here as fields. We need another field in order to measure the temperature. Okay, in order to do so, we just click here, say multiline data, and now I can add T for the temperature in Kelvin, by the way. We can copy this and also copy this, replace that with T. I will turn this off here first. We need to recalculate everything, so that's why it's better to just turn everything off. I want to give the walls a temperature, which represents my indoor temperature. I would say I have 26. There could be another complete tutorial about how to determine the temperature of the different walls and different sides of the building, but step by step. And then we have the temperature of the inlet boundary, which is the outdoor temperature. I would just put a number here, but we will look at this later in a bit more detail. Let's say outdoor is really hot, 45 degrees. I don't know exactly what happens actually when this has also temperature. Maybe that has also temperature. Let's say the outlet has a temperature. Not sure if that makes sense. Could be on a different side of the building. 30, let's say. And now let's run that. I changed the name here. Indoor temperature, that's what I'm gonna do. Okay, still very quick. We do the snappy hex mesh. It's fairly quick because it's a very simple model. And now we can run this. I hope I didn't forget anything. These are all have, there is a reference temperature in here. I think let's just skip it. And then we can just run this. For now, we still haven't connected yet the temperature here. So this is still like the old, still like the same script as before. Just the difference is that now we specified temperature and we also have a second field here. Still going. The calculation is now more difficult, so it's actually going really far. And I have 1000 as a final iteration. Probably could go longer because it might still calculate and might try to refine it. But for this example, it's let's keep it. We could plot the residuals fields, but I did a video about that. So if you go into my into the playlist for the CFD butterfly CFD, if you go into the butterfly CFD playlist in the show notes, I'm gonna put the link in the show notes. Then you can also see you can see how to set up the residual fields. Or go into the example files. The example files in the installation folder for Butterfly CFD are very, very useful. Just saying. And now we have the values. These are in Kelvin, so we want to have that, of course, in Celsius. Easier to understand here in the old world. So we have Kelvins. If you want to read it in Kelvins, it's fine. Then you can directly put this in here. And you can see the heat distribution in the room. We will look at the maximum and minimums here a bit more, just in a bit. Now, if we want to change that, we just need to subtraction. And here we're gonna put 273.15. That's the number. And that gives us, it doesn't change. It doesn't change because it automatically adjusts the maximum and minimum. So if we look here, and now we place this tool here, the minimum and maximum, and we can actually look at the output that is 35 to 52. That's the minimum and maximum. It's getting pretty hot here. It's wondering how accurate this is. Let's try something else. I will remove this here and let's rerun it. I want to know what's happening. So I definitely need to read a bit more about the outlet boundary temperature and how that actually changes the values. Now has quite a different result without the outlet boundary temperature. I'm wondering now if I do something different. I want to actually have indoor more temperature than outdoor. Let's see. So I have indoor, it's really hot, like 30 degrees, so it's heating, and then hopla. And then outdoor, it's actually cold. It's like 2 degrees or 5. So if you make this more interesting, I'm just mentioning what you can do. I will push this a bit away, and we're gonna give this a location and a real weather date. So we could get the download weather data all from Ladybug, from the Ladybug tools, from Ladybug, and we need the input weather data. These are the three elements we need for that, because we have here the dry pulp temperature. So the weather URL tool, where we can import where the file is. That could be also on your computer, by the way. If it's on your computer, you just need to place your location of on the computer, the folder location into here, and then text string, and then put it in here. Otherwise, you're gonna use this tool, and we're gonna just boolean toggle. That's what we need to the weather map. Let's go somewhere that's pretty cold. Norway. Copy, place it here. If this goes gray, it's a good sign. Yeah, then I place this here. And then I just check if there's something in here. Yes, there is. Make sure you understand that we can't put that temperature just in here. That doesn't work. We could average the temperature, but we still need to first deconstruct the data. So we have headers in here, and then we have values in here. It's like this. And the average temperature in Bergen in Norway is 7 degrees. So we could use that. Or we're gonna choose a specific day a specific hour. And that we could do by choosing the analysis period. Just place here start month, start day, let's just choose 7. I'm lazy. Start day 7th of July, start hour 7 o'clock in the morning. And now we can apply the period. This is this tool here. Ladybug apply analysis period. We could average, of course, later on again if we want, if we have a certain period, if we measure a whole month. But we could now go in here, put the date, the data in here, and we have the period in here, and that should give us, no, sorry, that works different. We don't need, we just put this in here. We don't need this anymore. Just, and now we should have, well, we need it again, actually. So in that case, we do this. And the values, okay, we have two values. That was my fault. We just put in here 7, then we just have 1 hour. And it has 12 degrees. And now with that, we can, instead of using this, we can just use this. Yeah, that's it. So that's pretty much it, what I want to show you. Now the next step would be to look at a combination of honeybee, butterfly, ladybug, maybe dragonfly. Then we have all the tools from the ladybug tool, all the ladybug tools plus butterfly together in one. That would be pretty interesting to see. For example, how to measure the indoor temperature in the first place would be interesting. That we could do with honeybee, and then measure how that could, how you could use the airflow from outside in order to cool your indoor space as a passive way of cooling. All right, that's it. See you in the next videos, hopefully. Just click on the link on the next video. As soon as there is a link, you can click on that, and that's the video, that's the follow-up video where we discuss the same principle with an air conditioning unit. All right, stay tuned and see you in the next videos.